Hello, and welcome to the third episode of our Appium tutorial series. Today we will be installing and running Appium on Ubuntu, as well as writing our first Appium test and running it live on a real device we have connected to our machine. During this tutorial, we will download some files from different sources. This list, which you can also find in the description below, contains links to all these resources. The first thing we will have to do is to install our IDE of choice. For this tutorial, we'll be using IntelliJ IDE, but feel free to use the one that you're most familiar with. The community edition of IDE will be enough for our purpose. Download it and install it in your machine. If you navigate on the Android's developer website and scroll down to the bottom of the page, you will find a link to the Android SDK for Linux. Download it for the moment. We will show you how to set it up later in this video. If you already have it on your device, there is no need to download it again though. You will also need to make sure your device is properly set up for development as shown in official documentation. Another requirement is the Selenium standalone server. We will download the latest version from the official website. Next is the Appium Java client, which we will also need to include in our project. For our example, we will be downloading the jar file directly and adding it to our project. Lastly, we will need to download Appium itself from the official website. Here, you will find a step-by-step guide on how to install Appium in your machine. The first step is to get Node.js. You can get it by running this command on the command line, or by visiting the official Node.js website. After Node.js has been set up, we'll go on and install Appium. After following through all the steps successfully, we can finally run Appium. To do this, we simply type in Appium in the terminal. After we do that, we will start seeing the server logs appear in the terminal. Before we can actually start testing on Android, we need to properly set up our Android SDK. To do so, open the SDK package that we previously downloaded. Then, navigate to the Tools folder and right-click and select Properties. Here, you will need to copy the path to the current folder. Navigate to the copied path and run the Android SDK manager. Here, we can manage and install Android packages. Currently, the only things we need to install are the Android SDK tools, the platform tools, and the build tools. As you can see here, I had installed these previously already, but if you have just downloaded the SDK for the first time, you probably need to install them. This is easily achieved by selecting the packages and clicking the Install Packages button. Since we are already working with the Android SDK, let's take a minute to set the Android Home Environment variable. To do this, we need to edit our bash.rc file situated in our home folder. While we're at it, we can also add a couple of directories to our path variable for convenience. Once we are done, we save our changes. restart the terminal,
and then print out our path variable to see if the changes we have made have taken effect.
Once all these things are set up, we can move on to the first step of our automation process, inspecting the application's UI. For this, we will be using a tool called UI Automator Viewer, which is part of the Android SDK. To show you what's going on our local device, I will use an application called Visor, which is going to mirror the screen on my Android phone. After opening the application, we want to test on our local device. We will be able to take a snapshot of the UI structure of our application in the UI Automator Viewer by clicking on the Device Screenshot button in the top left corner of the program. What this allows us to do is navigate the application's UI element by element to find ways to reference buttons, text fields, labels, and other UI elements we might be interested in. For example, if we are interested in selecting this element, we can see several attributes that will allow us to reference it in our test script, like its content, resource ID, and several others. When we open another screen in the app, we will need to capture the screen again to get its updated content. Before we start writing any code, we need to install the Java Development Kit, unless, of course, it has already been installed in our machine. The procedure is quite simple. First off, add a new repository right from your command line. Next, run apt-get-update. At this point, we can install the JDK. It's finally time to start writing our first test. Let's start by creating a new project in our IDE. First of all, make sure that you have the Java JDK selected as Project SDK. Once that has been taken care of, enter a group ID and artifact ID of your choosing. Finally, supply a project name to finish the project setup. Once the project has been created, we need to import the libraries we have just downloaded. In IDE, this is achieved by navigating to File, Project Structure, then clicking on Libraries. To add new libraries, click on the green plus sign in the top portion of the window, then select Java. The next step is to navigate to the Java client and Selenium libraries and add them to the project. Finally, apply the changes. It's now time to navigate to our test Java folder and create a new class where we will be writing our test. To do so, right-click on the test Java directory and select New. Then, Java class. In this class, we will define three methods. First up is our setup method, which carries the before annotation, as it has to be executed before every test method. Next up is the teardown method, annotated with the after annotation, which will run after every test. Finally, we write our test method, which we annotate as test. Our setup method will take care of initializing the connection with the Appium server. Before we instantiate the Appium driver, which is responsible for the communication with the server, we need to provide it with some information by setting some capabilities. The first capability will be device name. You can provide any device name if you are using a real device, but the capability needs to be there. Once that has been taken care of, we need to specify which platform we will be testing against. You can also specify capabilities using the Capability Type class, as we are demonstrating here. Since we will be testing on an Android device, we will specify Android as the chosen platform. We will also need to let Appium know which version of the aforementioned operating system we are targeting. Finally, we will need to specify the app capability, which will be the path to the APK file of the app we want to test. Once that is done, we have everything we need to instantiate the Appium driver. In this case, it is going to be the Android driver, as we will be testing on Android. To instantiate the driver, we'll need to provide it with a capability object and the Appium endpoint. It is very important that we close the session when our test has ended. This is achieved by calling driver.quit in the teardown method. We are now ready to start writing our test method. To start things off, we will grab the login button from the application's initial screen. There are many ways in which we can reference a UI element. We will be referencing our button using its resource ID. To find out the ID of the button we have selected, we need UI Automator Viewer. Clicking on the button will highlight it and reveal its details in the bottom right frame. We are then able to copy the resource ID and paste it in our test method. Now that we have access to this element, we can perform a click on it. Before we can execute our test, we need to write in the actual Appium endpoint and specify the path to the commute APK. We are finally ready to run our first test. Select Run and then the class we have just created. We will need to wait for some seconds while the app gets installed on the device. Then, if we take a look at the screen of our smartphone, we will notice the app will boot up and the login button is clicked. As soon as the test ends, the session is then terminated and the app closed. As we can see from our IDE, our first test has passed. While we managed to interact with our test device by executing a test script, we haven't yet run a proper test. Let's add a few more steps to our test method. The procedure will be the same. Navigate to the screen where the element you want to interact with is located. Find a way to reference the element through UI Automator Viewer. Then, paste it in your test method. In this case, we are using a slightly different approach to grab the UI element. We are waiting for up to 30 seconds for it to appear. This is because it might take some time for the screen to load and the element to show up. Once we have the element, we paste some text into it with the sendKeys method. We can factor out the string to keep the code a little bit tidier. So we just create a string variable and put it inside. We want to check what happens if we try to log in with invalid credentials. So, first we replicate the test manually on the device. As expected, we are greeted by an error message.
We want to make sure this is showing up when we are trying to log in with invalid credentials.
So we go through the usual procedure. The basis for our assertion will be that the error dialog that is showing up is the one containing the right error message. We can now run our complete test. We can see that the app is getting installed. The first login button is clicked. Then we are entering the invalid credentials. And finally clicking the second login button, after which the alert is shown. Congratulations! You have just run your first automated test with Appium. Adding further tests now is just a matter of writing new test methods with the procedure you have just learned. We hope this video has been useful. If you are interested in running Appium tests in the cloud or multiple real devices, please visit us at testobject.com.